the whole semester is divided into three main parts. There is the linear, the rotational, and everything else. We have just begun the second part. Linear motion, we're all familiar with. We have position, time, mass, velocity, acceleration, and you start mixing these things together and you also get force. But now we have to add a few other items in our repertoire of terms. We're gonna have momentum. Energy. And we're gonna start developing on these terms and their rotational cousins. So we have the linear world, and then we have the rotational world. And a couple of things that we're doing is momentum and energy are kind of new. We have to think about this. Hold on, let me get these things set up. Is that bright enough? Dark enough? Could be darker, could be sharper. There we go. The couple of words that we need to work on are for momentum and for energy. Now, with momentum, it's the equation P is equal to mv, that the momentum is equal to mass times velocity. So if I had like a bowling ball, and I like had a student over there and I just bowled it right at them, the bowling ball has a specific velocity and has a specific mass, which leads to a little bit of that, oh my goodness, I'm gonna get smacked by this object. Now the object also has energy, and there is the idea of linear kinetic energy. Now, linear kinetic energy is E equals 1/2 mv squared. The momentum is just the mass times the velocity, mass being kilograms and velocity being meters per second. There is no catchy phrase for momentum. It's just kilograms, meters per second. Energy, on the other hand, the mass is in kilograms, the velocity is in meters per second, it's squared, so a kilogram meter squared per second squared. Now what we're going to do is we can also change this around to kilograms meters per second squared times a meter. And what is a kilogram meter per second? It's a joule. Or I'm sorry, it's not a joule, it's a newton. So a newton meter are the effective units of energy, or linear energy. if I threw something at you, it would have a specific amount of energy. It would have a momentum, mass times velocity, but it would also have an amount of energy. The other short phrase that we could use is that kilograms, meters squared, second squared, and Newton meters is a joule, or short for, or shorten it to J. So a joule is a Newton meter, and it's also a kilogram meter second, or meter squared per second squared. And these quantities are very important for collisions and motion. To understand how two objects collide, you have to understand their energy and their momentum. These are terms that will be used in greater detail. Today is kind of a vocabulary dump. I'm just going to unload all these words on you. Energy, we see that Newton meter is a way of expressing energy, or the linear energy. Newton meter, which is energy, can also be obtained from work. A force times a distance will give you the units of work, which is, once again, the units of joule. Force, Newton. Distance, meter. And so when you have a force multiplied by a distance, you get the units of energy. In, as an example, this book has a certain amount of mass. And because it's under the influence of gravity, I'm experiencing a force on my hand. The force that I'm pushing against is the mass of the book times gravity, mg. So if I take that mg and push it up a certain distance, the amount of work that I've done on that object is mg times that distance, or height change. It is this change in energy, the work being done, the linear kinetic energy is expressed as 1/2 mv squared. There is generic work, which is force times distance, which again gives you a variety of energy. But there is also gravitational potential energy. And gravitational potential energy is mgh. And the way that I typically write potential energy is I just write PE. Just like kinetic energy, I write KE. Now, a lot of times the individual letters are mostly just one big letter and a subscript, but it's the way that I do it. So big PE, potential energy, big KE is kinetic energy. Now, describing, I mean, we're really just touching the light parts of everything. We have a book. I put in a certain amount of force, which lifts it up a particular distance. So now it has a potential energy. So what happens when I do this? The potential, in addition to getting class's attention, the potential energy of the book, as it's falling, is speeding up, it's accelerating. Which means that the potential energy here, when compared to the energy at the bottom, it's 100% converted from potential to kinetic. If there's no friction. Yay, no friction. So with, when I think of potential energy, and don't worry, don't think that about what I'm gonna do is just because it's you guys, I do this to every class. So for potential energy, how I tend to think of it as something that gets your attention. If I hold the book like this, not sure how long I can hold it. If I drop it, it'll kind of bounce on your head. You go, ow, why'd you do that? But if I hold it up like this, this has her attention. Why? It's going to hit your head really hard. And why is it going to hit your head really hard compared to him? I added more potential by increasing the height. Now, let's say I wanted to just drop the book from here. It's going to have a particular potential energy. How do I want for this book to hit her head with the same energy as this head, but I'm only going to drop it from here? Have a bigger book. So if I double the mass of the book, I double the potential energy. If I double the height of the book, I double the potential energy. Now let's talk about kinetic energy. So if I took this book and boom, threw it at you, that hurt. Now, let's say I'm going over one of these people over here to who are not paying attention, and I want to throw the book at them, but I want it to hurt harder because they're not listening. I can do one of two things. What's the first thing that I could do to make the book hurt harder? I throw it harder, as in I increase the velocity, or get a bigger book. So get a bigger book, increase mass, increase velocity, increase energy as well. One of the interesting things about which would hurt harder, me getting a bigger book that's twice as big and then throwing it, or me using the same book and throwing it twice as fast. Twice as fast, why?
It aggresses every day.
Not exponentially. It's squared. The energy is a function of velocity squared. So if I double the velocity, what do I do with the energy? I quadruple. This is one of the reasons why those police are such jerks by asking you not to speed. Because when you're driving at 50 miles an hour and you suddenly decide to hot dog it at 110, you're driving with four times the energy as you would at 55. One of the reasons why, just as a practical note, why do NASCAR vehicles disintegrate when they hit the wall? They're going 200 miles an hour, but that's a lot of energy. So what they want to do is they want to separate that energy away from the driver. That's why the first thing that happens in a NASCAR collision like that are the big fat tires just fly off into the crowd, which is always a joy. Then there's the engine block, which separates. The engine block's like several hundred pounds. And they're trying to separate the person from all that energy flying around, because energy, such as this book, just hitting somebody. I'm not hitting anybody. Justin Bieber, man. It presents energy into another object. That energy is perceived as bones breaking, organs smashing. I mean, there are real world situations for this energy going into you. The other thing about, and this is one of the philosophy things about the way that I teach, is yes, I do make myself look like an idiot in front of the class, but one of the things it does is you remember. All right, this has a certain amount of potential energy. I move it over here. How did its potential energy change? It didn't. Well, how about if I do this? Does the potential energy change? It's still the same. Remember, when we're talking about potential energy in motion, what we care about is the beginning of the motion and the end of the motion. What it does in the middle, I'm not concerned about. It could do this, as long as there is still level. It could do this, but if it's at the same level, what's the change in potential energy? Zero. So no matter how you look like a fool during the motion, all that matters is the beginning and the ending points. And now you all are afraid of me. Goal achieved. So for this world that we're living in, we've been playing with position, time, mass, velocity, acceleration, and force. We've introduced momentum and energy. More terms will become available, but I needed this stuff right now. Position, meter, time, second, mass, kilogram, velocity, meter per second, acceleration, meter per second squared, force, newton, momentum, kilogram, meter per second, and energy, joule, newton meter, stuff like that. In the rotational world, and really what I'm doing right now is I'm putting together, I call it the Rosetta Stone of linear and rotational motion, just to keep us educationally, have a certain educational depth. Do we all know what the Rosetta Stone is? Back in Napoleonic times, they found a stone which had a proclamation in old Egyptian, I think modern Egyptian, or what they called modern Egyptian, and ancient Greek. And they were able, from that one stone, they had never understood why, what hieroglyphs was. And so from that Greek translation, they were able to figure out the whole language. What this is doing is it's trying to make the associations between the linear and the rotational world. In rotation, you don't have position, you have angle. And angle is measured in theta, and its units we will use as radians. Time, thank goodness, time is still the same. Sometimes you write rad. Another thing about radians is technically radians are unitless. Now, we're all familiar with degrees, but one thing that we need to get to understand is that when you're really thinking about motion, you're not thinking about degrees, you're thinking about arcs. How much does it span across a system or the laboratory frame or whatever? 2 pi is equal to 360 degrees. Now, I would accept 2 pi radians because I like to know what I'm talking about. Technically, that is not, it really shouldn't be there. It's just, I mean, 2 pi radians is just 2 pi. It's the arc. A 2 pi radian arc is a full circle. If I said pi, the arc is pi, that would be a semicircle. If I said pi, like full circle, 2 pi, half circle, pi, quarter circle, pi over 2, and so on. So whatever fraction of a circle is, it's based on 2 pi being a full circle. For mass, it's moment of inertia. And it is typically, I stands for moment of inertia, just as X, T, M, V, A, F, P, and E all stand for those things. Rotational moment of inertia. What is, you can even use moment of inertia on this. Moment, linear mass, it requires a linear force to have it accelerate. A moment of inertia is rotational mass. Given a certain rotational force, and I'll tell you that word in just a moment, but given a certain rotational force, it will accelerate at a different rate. If this was a very tightly bound little ball with this mass, I could spin it up very quickly. If it was the same mass ball, but it was like this big around, it would require a greater rotational force to get it to spin up. Spinning up, rotationally accelerating, spin down, rotationally decelerating. This has a linear momentum and a linear mass. When I'm thinking about rotating it like this or this or that, it has a certain rotational mass, and we'll get into that.
Is energy E or F?
E. My E's tend to be mutants. Moment of inertia, we'll get into its equations very soon. Velocity, rotational velocity, is angular momentum. And angular momentum is L. Now, because all the really cool letters went away when the linear motion needed them, now we gotta pick out weird thing. Moment of inertia, I. L, I guess the L from angular, I don't know. I mean, one of the interesting things is, why is momentum called, use P? Because it's all based, momentum has an original form, impetus, or impulse, and the P comes from that word. So if you look it up, it's all kind of related. Acceleration, angular, oh wait, hold on, ooh, bad, bad, bad. I'm at the wrong point. Angular velocity, velocity, linear velocity. Rotational velocity, angular velocity, which is omega. Angular momentum is down here. Which is L. Now, angular velocity, I say, is omega. That is a lowercase omega, or some people just say W. My W's will try to look like this. In fact, I mean, there's a W in work, and that omega look about the same thing. When you type it out, lowercase omega does does look dramatically different from W, but when you're writing it, they tend to look alike. Acceleration, angular acceleration. And it is alpha. A couple of examples with this stuff, with the book again. The book is moving with a certain linear velocity. It's moving in a linear fashion from one place to another. Having an angular velocity means it's rotating. So if it has an angular velocity, this thing's spinning. Angular acceleration, which is alpha. If it has no alpha, it will either A, just sit there and not rotate, or B, it will slowly start rotating and rotate faster and faster and faster. It's spinning up. Say you had a car wheel. You put your car in drive and you start. Initially, the wheel is slowly turning. The faster you go, the faster that the wheel spins. That means it has an alpha. When you put on your brakes, this thing is spinning and then it starts slowing down. So if you put your brakes on the car slows down, the tires decrease their angular velocity, their rotation rate. So what I'm trying to do is make all the analogies between all of those. Yes, I know, brain. So.
Yes,
we can do the units. Angular velocity is in radians per second. Angular acceleration is in radians per second squared. Another way of describing the units are simply inverse seconds or inverse seconds squared. Personally, I keep the radians in just so that when I see a radian wandering around, I know that I'm dealing with an angular quantity. The units for inertia? Well, I can might as well give it to you now. Kilograms, meters squared. We're going to talk about moment of inertia. Force is torque. Rotational force is called torque. And it has the units of, it looks like work, Newton meters. And all these terms we're gonna be going over the next like 3 weeks. So if you sit there and go, I have no idea what he's talking about. It's the first day of class, effectively. We'll get into this more and more. Energy, you've got linear energy, which is 1/2 mv squared, kinetic. And then you have rotational kinetic energy, which is joules or Newton meters. And we'll go over what this is. Sometimes I write it like KE/ROT, whereas energy over here would be KE/LIN. It's kind of interchangeable. So what I'm doing here is I'm setting up the words. In a linear world, you're worried about position. In a rotational world, you're learning about angle. If you're not dealing with velocity because you're in rotational, you're dealing with angular velocity. Instead of meters per second, it becomes radians per second. A joule in the linear world is the same as a joule in the rotational world. They're both energies. Instead of force, you're using torque. Newton now uses Newton meter. I know these are a lot of new words, but we're going to start doing problems in a little bit. Yes?
What's the symbol for torque?
Symbol before torque, tau. So those of you in the Greek system have a leg up. Omega, alpha, tau, theta. Everything else is standard stuff.
So torque and rotational kinetic energy are both in Newton meters?
Yes. They both have just common units. It's just one of the quirks of things. We'll get into that. Do I expect you to understand all the words on this page right now? No way. But what I am doing is I'm trying to get that part of your brain that goes, I understand motion, I understand acceleration and forces. I kind of got a firm grasp on energy right now and going, oh, there's a linear world and there's a rotational world, and they are kind of similar in how they look. In linear, you know about the position equation, x equals x naught plus v naught t plus 1/2 at squared. In the rotation world, it is theta equals theta naught plus omega naught t plus 1/2 alpha t squared. The x becomes the theta, the v becomes omega, the a becomes alpha, and everything else remains the same. Time remains the same. The naughts are still the same. When you see the naught as a subscript, that just means the initial or original position. The next part would be velocity equation, v equals v naught plus at. Its rotational cousin is omega equals omega naught plus alpha t. Momentum, we have mv, and m becomes I, so momentum becomes, or I'm sorry, not momentum, angular momentum becomes I omega. Kinetic energy for linear is 1/2 mv squared. Kinetic energy rotational is 1/2 I omega squared. So we can see that the equations that we've studied for the last couple of weeks, you tweak the letters and you can get the rotational variance of whatever you're looking for. Force, mass times acceleration. Rotational force becomes torque. Mass becomes I. A becomes alpha. So those are the associated things between force and torque. Position, mass, I need to talk about mass, hold on. Velocity, acceleration, force to torque, momentum, yes, energy, yes. All right, so we've covered, these are the equations that we use for motion. When you have an object that moves from left to right and has an acceleration to it, you could figure out where it is after a particular time, and you could figure out its velocity. Let's say from rest, a wheel rotates 30 times in 5 seconds. What is alpha? What is the angular acceleration of the wheel? And what is um, alpha, and what's a good number? Oh, what is the final angular velocity after those 5 seconds? So once again, you identify it as a rotational problem, just as if I said a car going across the table is a linear problem. And you would sit there and go, well, I gotta write theta equals theta naught plus omega naught t plus 1/2 alpha t squared, and omega equals omega naught plus alpha t. So those are the two big equations. Now, in many of these equations, there are special conversion equations, equations that you need in order to accomplish some specific task. The big one is 2 pi n is equal to theta. Every rotation means you rotate 2 pi radians. So if I say you rotate one time, how many radians of rotation is that? 2 pi. Or when, hold on, I think I understand what you're getting. For radians, keep pi. One rotation, 2 pi. Two rotations, 4 pi. Right now, don't try to give me a decimal number for this, unless I specifically ask for it numerically. Keep everything in terms of pi. Makes things easier. Plus, who doesn't love pie? Apple pie, myself. Little vanilla ice cream. Now, with these angles and this conversion, this theta, I can rewrite it as 2 pi n. The next thing we need to understand is in physics 213 problem sets, tests, and final, theta naught will equal 0. Theta naught is the initial position of the wheel, the initial position of the system. Much like we choose the origin to be the starting point, and what does it mean to choose the origin as the starting point? X naught and Y naught are both 0. We're going to do the same thing with theta naught. There will be one lecture example in the 14th week or 13th week where theta naught isn't 0, and it has a very, very important reason. I'll give a hint. It's all about money. You'll remember this moment when it comes. So when you do these problems, theta naught always 0. It will never be non-zero on a test. It will never be non-zero on a final. It will never be non-zero on my problem sets. So that goes away. Omega naught is 0. Why? Good way to mimic, and you incorrect answer. Your attitude was almost appropriate. So, okay, I'll let it slide. I think someone else had the answer.
Starts from rest.
Starts from rest. What were the first two words of the problem? From rest. When you see from rest, that is me telling you this object's angular initial velocity is 0. So that goes away. And I'm left with 1/2 alpha t squared. Get the green and red pens going. I know n, that's 30. I know t, that's 5. I'm not going to bother working with the other equation because at this moment, I can solve for alpha. 4 pi n over t squared equals alpha. So 4 pi, this is where we'll need a number. 4 pi times n. N is 30. T is 5. So it's 120 pi over 25. radians per second squared. Now alpha is a known quantity, and if alpha is a known quantity, I think that other particular equation will turn out more nicely. So omega naught is zero, so we don't have to worry about that. Alpha and T are known quantities. So alpha is 15.08, T is 5. So roughly 60.4, no, 75.4. Radians per second, I think. Okay, and so that's a very simple example. Yes?
I'm confused on what you did with n. What does n mean in that first equation?
Okay. N is the number of rotations. So when I say, from rest, a wheel rotates 30 times in 5 seconds. That lets me know that I'm screaming N equals 30 at you.
I think it was using the capital N is what threw them
off. Oh, the capital N?
Yeah.
Capital. Point taken. Changes nothing. It's Mardi Gras. Why are we also being so serious? Now, one of the things that I do on tests, and when you look at previous tests, you get this. Let's change this for an instance. I'm only going to change one value. From rest, a wheel rotates 30 times in 2 times the square root of pi seconds. So 2 times the square root of pi seconds. And you could go, well, why doesn't he say 3.5449 seconds. Well, let me show you why. Dr. Eschenberg, like you, is lazy. Or as I like to say, efficient. In these problems, alpha is 4 pi n over t squared. Plugging in these values, it would be 4 pi times 30. And this time squared is 2 times the square root of pi squared, which is equal to 4 pi. And so t squared is in fact 4 pi, which means alpha is now 30. Dr. Eschenberg loves for stuff to cancel out. Because Dr. Eschenberg hates using calculators. If you could just plug stuff in, why plug in 4 pi times 30 divided by 4 pi when you know that 4 pi divided by 4 pi is 1? So when you see this type of problem, a wheel rotates 30 times and 2 times the square root of pi seconds, I'm either A, being a complete jerk, or B, I'm not really interested in you guys using numbers. I want stuff to cancel. So that's why I intentionally throw in these weird pi numbers and stuff like that. Because I'm really, trust me, I am interested on the ideas. So a lot of times I make a mockery of the numbers. All right. Whew. Where to go next? Let's talk about moment of inertia. Let's talk about moments of inertia for the book. Now, we've got the book, and probably what's the easiest way to rotate the book? You rotate it like this. Pretty easy. I know that, hold on, this is just a side note. This is what the book looks like. There was one time I didn't bring the book, and I needed to refer something like a constant. And I said, all right, I'm going to set the bet, the over-under on the number of books in this room. The room was full. It was like a 213 fall class. I'm going to set the over-under at 0.5, which means no one would take the over, which is amazing, which basically said the whole room, including the professor, didn't bring a single book to class. And there was no book. So currently, my best guess is this is the only book in the room. Now, when you spin it like this, it's kind of easy to rotate. Get like, all right, here's another thing. Back before the internet, we had to get dead trees and use ink to print on their little pages and stuff. So at home, you got a book, get one of those big books. Like my family has, I've got it now. It's the Random House Unabridged Dictionary. This thing is a monster. It's like four times thick as this and about that wide and that tall. And it's, you don't want to, feel free to try to steal that thing because you ain't going far with that. So you could spin this book like this, and you could spin this book like this. It's the same mass. But if I try to spin this book around, it's a little bit harder. Now, why is it a little bit harder? It's the same mass. Well, the thing about this is it's changing its rotation point. When I'm rotating it around this, the center of mass of the book runs right down here, and the extremes to either side is only a few inches. If I rotate it like this, the center of mass of rotation is right down here, and it's a little bit further. If you notice, it's harder to spin it like this a little bit than like this. Try to spin it like this. Try to sit there and go flip, flop, flip, flop. It hurts. So what is happening now is the rotation point is here, and all this mass is hanging out over there, and I've got to turn it all around. That is a good description of what moment of inertia is. I'm trying to think of another good analogy. Probably when you go to lab and you've got those like meter sticks, take a meter stick and hold it by the middle and just wiggle it, kind of easy. Then grab it at its edge, one of the ends, and try to wiggle it again. It's way harder. And let's talk about that. It's rotational mass, and really our world will be revolving around points. Discs. Sticks. And combinations of the above. So a point revolving, and anything else I mention, like I think in one of the problem sets I talk about a revolving hollow sphere. You can look this stuff up on Wikipedia. But in terms of the tests, I'll give you these, I'll tell you what it is, and then I'll give you the moments of inertia. With one exception, but I'm gonna teach it to you in a little bit. I don't remember what the moments of inertia are of these bizarre things. I know the basics. Where do these moments of inertia come from? Calculus. So we're not really allowed to discuss how the origin comes from. It's from calculus. A point revolving around itself its moment of inertia is zero because it is a point mass. It has nothing to revolve around itself because it is what it is. It's just a little itty bitty point. But a point orbiting in a circle its moment of inertia is mr squared. So if you have, let's say, think of a, I know it really it's a sphere, but if you had a cue ball and it's just, and you say that's a point mass and it's just rotating around itself, it would have no moment of inertia. But if that cue ball or point mass is rotating in a circle, it has a particular moment of inertia, which is its mass times radius squared. A disk is its mass and its radius, and its moment of inertia is 1/2 mr squared. So you've got the disk, it rotates around one point, there's the radius, and the moment of inertia is 1/2 mr squared. Now, this is the mass of the disk, that's the mass of the point. So they're different. Why is the 1/2 there? Calculus. For sticks, and this is the rotation directly through the middle. So it's spinning, yeah, think of it like a turntable. So like a record. Back in the days, we didn't have sound on the internet. We actually grew things in plastic called records. And then we put a needle in them and they'd spin around. It's amazing how much tech has changed. I have 8-track tapes. If you don't know what they are, you don't deserve to know what they are. 8-track tapes are awesome. They look like kind of like a thicker Kindle version, but really all it is just a big tape. And you look at one end, and there's a big strip of tape, and you put it in into your Wi-Fi player. Usually it's in a 1976 Chevy van, and he plays disco, mostly, and ABBA. So ABBA? It's a great band.
I just swear it's not.
We're going to get to that. And Styx, the moment of inertia of a stick rotating about its center of mass is 1/12 ml squared. These are the big objects. Object rotating in a circle, a disc rotating about its center of mass, like a turntable, and then a stick where it is rotating about its center of mass. That's short for center of mass, because I hate writing stuff like that down. So, she asks an interesting question. If you think of, well, instead of flipping the book, so let's say this has a mass and it has a particular length, and I ask for, well, what's the moment of inertia of this thing if I'm rotating it like that? And you go 1/12 ml squared. Do you have to remember 1/12 ml squared? Oh, heavens no, it will be given to you. But what I do expect you to understand is, how does it change from 1/12 ml squared to this? What's the moment of inertia when you rotate the object not around its center of mass, but about any given point? Thank you for asking. Let me teach it to you. What you have to know is, it has a fancy schmancy name. We could go and discuss the meaning of the words, but we're not. We're just going to talk about how to use it. It's called the parallel axis theorem. Ooh, a whole lot of words, a whole lot of syllables. Let me tell you what it means. When you are, and you know how I hate writing stuff down, which means this is important, rotating an object about a point not at its center of mass, its new moment of inertia, I prime, equals its I about its center of mass, plus md squared. And let's talk about, so, obvious question, what do all those letters mean? Well, the ICM is the moment of inertia of the center of mass. The original moment of inertia when it's rotating about its center of mass. Well, what's M? Well, M is the mass of the object. And what's D? Well, D is the distance from that center of mass to the rotation point. And what we're going to do in the last 10 minutes is we're going to do one using the stick and one using the disc. So L is the length of the stick. What is the... We're going to talk about it. So let's say, what is I prime for a stick of mass M rotate and length L rotating about one of its ends? So it's exactly like, what's the difference between this and this? How does that moment of inertia change? You've got to use the parallel axis theorem. I prime equals ICM plus MD squared. What's the moment of inertia of a stick rotating about its center of mass? 1/12 ML squared. What's the mass of the object? The mass of the stick. Now, the whole key to this is choosing the right value for D. D in this case is the distance from the center of mass where it would normally rotate to its rotation point. Because we, now I could choose any point, but in this particular case, I'm choosing the end of the stick. What is the value of D? 1/2 L. So 1/2 L squared. So this becomes 1/12 ML squared plus 1/4 ML squared. ML squared 1/12 plus 1/4, common factor of 12, and you get 1/3 ML squared. Now, if you're to have one of these rare objects known as the textbook, and you actually opened it up to the section on moments of inertia, it would tell you that the moment of inertia of a stick is 1/12 about its center of mass, but 1/3 if rotating around one of its ends. And so this is used, I use this as a confirmation of the parallel axis theorem to get a very simple version. To answer someone else's question, what's the moment of inertia of the disk that's rotating about its edge? Moment of inertia of the disk has a mass M and a radius R. The new moment of inertia is the center of mass moment of inertia plus MD squared. Center of mass for a disk, 1/2 MR squared. The mass is M, and in this case, what is the value of D? R. So this becomes 3/2 MR squared. And that's how you determine moments of inertia, when it's rotating about a strange thing. The biggest question you have to answer is, what's the value of D? An observation and one last thing. All I's are of the form kilograms and some distance squared. and really some number times mass times distance squared. 3/2 mR squared, 3/2 kilograms meters squared, 1/3 mL squared, number kilograms meters squared. The last thing is, and we'll do a problem not today, but later, eyes add like masses. If you have a 1 kilogram mass and a 2 kilogram mass, and you put them together, how much mass do you have? 3. If I have 1 kilogram meter squared moment of inertia object, and a 2 kilogram meter per square, or meter squared moment of inertia object, and I have them together, what's their total moment of inertia? 3. You just add them up exactly like masses. That's it. See you on Thursday.